let us know. I'm an attorney by trade, but I'm a soft-spoken attorney, so. Very unusual, but I don't speak loudly. And my daughter Marissa is also quiet-spoken, so. Just a little bit about me. I live in Fort Lee. I'm a member of the Teaneck Rotary. I've been in practice for about 35 years. I do real estate and personal injury, and do estate planning. My daughter, I adopted from China when she was 6 months old. Her name's Marissa. She'll tell you a little bit about herself. And we've started this project that's called Found Beginnings. As you look through this packet that we're giving out, the picture is Marissa when she was a little under 6 months old before she was adopted. And that was her original Chinese name, which was Li Xiao Yao. It's now Marissa Pico. So go ahead, tell them a little bit about
you. So I'm Marissa. I'm currently about to be a third-year law student at Boston University. I also went to BU for undergrad as well. And currently I'm working with my mom and our cousin who's a medical doctor on this organization that we started, which aims to connect adoptees with their biological relatives, whether it be siblings or biological parents. So we hope to do this through DNA. And what we've set up is this organization called Found Beginnings. So the adoptee would pay $99 to get the kit and become a member. We would send it to them. They would swab the inside of their cheek.
One thing, by the way, the kit prices are subsidized. We're a nonprofit, so if anybody can't afford it, we have people that fundraise for us, and we're looking to subsidize anybody that cannot afford it. So.
And so they would send the kit back to the lab, and we've partnered with a forensic lab called Universal Forensics, who has agreed to store all of the samples and compare them with any other incoming samples. So if you submitted your DNA, all of the other new DNA, your DNA would be compared against that to see if there were any matches. And then from there, if and when there is a match, we would facilitate the meeting between the two people, and hopefully they would allow us to document and memorialize the occasion, and we would use that to promote and inspire others to do the same.
So there's a great need for this. Back in the early 1990s, China instituted their one-child policy. I'm not sure if anybody is familiar with that situation. They ultimately, a few years ago, said it was okay to have more than one child, although it's still frowned upon to have more than one child. Marissa was caught up in that time frame where in the early 1990s they instituted that. So there were over, the statistic is approximately 300,000 girls a year were being abandoned. What happened was that the Chinese society is a patriarchal society, so they look for a son. In our society, it's a little bit different, but in that society, when they have a son, when they have a daughter, the daughter goes to the son's family, so the parents are left on their own to fend for themselves, and they always try and have a boy. So what would happen is that they would have a child who might be a girl. They would abandon that girl because they needed to have a boy. They'd abandon another girl, and maybe even another girl, till they got their boy. So this created this whole situation where there's all these children that are now out there in the world, be it in the United States, Canada, Australia, France, wherever they may have been adopted to. Plus there's a myriad of biological parents and sons that are in China that have no idea whatever happened to their biological kids or siblings. So we found that it was important, we thought, to help these people figure out what happened to these kids. I don't know if anybody has seen the movie Lion.
Yes.
Right? So it's not exactly the same, but it's a similar situation where we just don't know whether or not the biological parents know what happened to these kids. And obviously some of them have been and are very, very successful. I mean, my daughter, as you can see, is 22, finished college in 3 years, is a highly, accomplished athlete, and will be finishing law school next year. So, and there's many, many stories like that. So we feel that these biological parents, if they participate, would be happy to know what happened to these kids. The siblings also. I mean, Marissa could have a sibling that was adopted out in France who might be 2 years older than her. Then the parents tried again and had another child. So now Marissa's in the United States. And she might have a brother that's back somewhere in China. So we're looking to have, to expand this and try and see if we can get through to people that are willing to participate into the program. There are other situations such as Ancestry.com and 23andMe that do something sort of like what we do, but not exactly. What they do is somebody would deposit their DNA into this huge bank. you find out what your medical history is, you find out what your ethnicity is, but they're not focusing on trying to get people who have been in this same situation to come together into one DNA bank so that we can match them as easily, you know, more easily. So we're trying to do some type of outreach program through the Rotaries, either directly through, you know, anybody in the United States, or maybe partnering with another Rotary that might be in, for example, Australia, or might be, for example, in France, that we can possibly connect with them so that they can then go to the people that maybe were adopted out and see if we can get them to contribute the DNA into the data bank. The data bank is a highly regarded bank. It's called Universal Forensics. The testing that they do is much more complex than whatever Ancestry.com or 23andMe does. They have 40 different strands of DNA that they test and compare, where the other ones do between 15 and 20. So the chance of mistake for the other banks is much greater than our chance of mistake. It's the cutting edge of the forensic world. My cousin, who Mercis mentioned, is a medical doctor and has helped us with the program as well. So that's where we are. It's the website is called Found Beginnings. I've given you guys kind of a story about, you know, what our inspiration was and what our mission is and what we're looking to do. Yeah.
Question, you mentioned it. Blessed to have adopted a daughter.
Congratulations.
She's 13. Hope one day she's as accomplished as this young lady. She's newborn in the United States. But you mentioned international. Is this open to domestic?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I'm only mentioning international because of the Chinese. But there's potential for it in America as well, because not everybody knows who their birth parents are or who their siblings are. So if there's somebody who thinks potentially that their sibling might have been adopted out, we're looking to get that person to come to contribute their DNA. And if your daughter, for example, might think she has other siblings, we're looking to have her DNA come in. So it's not just Chinese adoptees, but it's anybody who might be looking for or searching for a relative. And we match them. When a match comes, people are coming into our program understanding that they want to be matched, right? So then we'll reach out to them once we have a match. And our goal is to make sure that they connect if they want to, but also to document, to facilitate the meeting, document the story, and hopefully publish it so that we can inspire others to kind of do this, so that it creates a whole circle of people finding each other.
Thank you.
That's great. You're welcome. There are about, it was figured out, there's about 80,000 or so adopted Asians, Chinese babies that came to the United States since the early 1990s. They are all over the world. We do this for Russian adoptees as well. There was a situation during the early 90s in the year 2000s where there was a great influx of Russian adoptees as well, Ukraine. So we're not limiting it, but you know, just because obviously Mercis Asian, we're focusing on that for now. Any questions or anything that we can help with?
How about just a nice story? You facilitate the meetings.
That would be great. We haven't had any meetings yet. I mean, we've just started this program about 4 months ago, although
okay.
It's been in fruition. It's been in the making for 22 years. So we finally kind of, you know, it coalesced and it came together, and we have things moving along. So we're looking for hopefully finding, I mean, everybody knows somebody who's adopted, right? Mm-hmm. So that's really where we're trying to go. And we thought that Rotary would be a great facilitator of that process. We are looking to hopefully do some fundraising, like I said before, for people that may not be able to afford the program. Like when we go into other countries, such as Russia or China, they may not have the ability to pay that $99 in American dollars. So we want to be able to provide those funds for them. Also, people in the United States, not everybody can afford that as well. We try and give discounts to students. We try and give discounts to anybody who might have already participated with another program for DNA, so they don't feel that they're paying twice for something. We don't want it to be one or the other. Yes, actually we are. We've been, for the past 2 months, we've been negotiating with the Rotaries in China to try and see if we can get them on the ground to bring in the biological relatives, because we feel that will then help. Kids can sometimes find their siblings, but it's hard to find the parents. And when the one child policy started, it was illegal for anybody to give up a child. They would wind up in prison, they would wind up with fines and penalties, they would get all their social services taken away, they wouldn't educate the second child. So when parents gave up their kids, they left with no identifying information. Because if it was ever traced back, they would be arrested. So that's why there's so many parents out there that have no idea what happened and how to do things because of social and economic reasons that we would never understand. So that's something that's really, you know, tough sometimes to hear, but, and not every child was lucky enough to wind up in an orphanage and then lucky enough to get adopted out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You mentioned like the 90s, so those parents, let's say right now they go and connect with their child, how is that gonna, like even though China has relaxed the laws, so how's that gonna impact them?
That's a good question, and we're working through that with the Chinese Rotaries. Okay, we don't think there's going to be any issues, but if there is, we'll deal with that. But there's all these siblings all over the world. So the adoption agencies and the orphanages, you know, there's many in Canada, there's many in France, there's many in Australia. So the girls were all adopted out. I mean, I'm sure Marissa has a couple sisters out there somewhere. You know, and everybody else does too. Because typically there's not just one child. I mean, you don't always get a boy the first time out, right? So, and that's really what the problem was for China. I mean, they've created this whole society now where they have a lot of men and no women. So they have huge armies and big problems. So it didn't really solve whatever it is they wanted. But, you know, it was an experiment that they did that didn't seem to quite do what they wanted.
So there's a great likelihood she has a brother.
Correct. That's correct. Yeah. And there's a likelihood she's probably one of the oldest because the brother would have stopped at the brother. So, yeah.
Now, do you find that some of these kids just don't care and don't want it because they're like kind of ticked off that they were abandoned?
Yes, yes, you do find
that. That's how I think I would feel. I can't put myself in your shoes at all, though.
Well, one of the things about the Chinese adoptees is that the pressure that was exerted on these people from the government was so great that nobody could withstand keeping a second child. It was very, very difficult. So if you start to understand that process, if you're a Chinese adoptee, you'll understand that you shouldn't be upset with your biological parents. You can be upset at the society, you can be upset at the country, at the government, but the parents that had to give up that kid to survive is a different type of situation than maybe what happens in other countries or in the United States with regard to anybody that's, you know, has to, that gives up for adoption. It's a different process, a mental process that they have to make. It's more of a survival. So I don't know. I mean, there are kids that feel that way, and Marissa, you can probably attest to this. There's a lot of adoption blogs that she's on and speaking with. My daughter, pretty comfortable with the situation, pretty mad at China, just exactly the way you said, but not mad at the birth parents. But there are kids, go ahead, that right. have issues with this.
Yeah, some do feel abandoned, and what I've found by just kind of reading through what people have posted is that kind of everybody has a different point of view, and it's not really a one size fits all type of thing. So it just really depends on who you ask. And you're right, so some people aren't comfortable, but some people do really want to find their biological relatives, so it just depends. But.
Yeah. Yes.
Do you have the wherewithal to tap into other DNA databanks? Like
no. Ancestry.com? No, they don't share. And they don't promote, or they're not trying terribly hard to get specific groups of people. I mean, we're trying to also, we're trying to target also the orphanages that were in China that particularly gave these kids up for adoption so that we can find those areas. We're trying to target areas, like there in the Northeast, there's a lot of Asian adoptees, right? So anybody, again, who you know, you probably know somebody who has a Chinese child. You know, there are a lot of, it's much more prolific than say in the center of the country. So, you know, it's a process. You know, we're trying to figure out how exactly to get the word out and get the DNA in, but there's no company or program that's actually trying to bring the biological parents, bring the siblings, and let these kids understand that there's a connection between them that they can come to this DNA bank. It's more focused. And it gives different information. I mean, you know, Ancestry.com and 23andMe give medical information. Like I said, they give ancestry information. I mean, obviously we know what the ancestry is, right? We don't have to worry about that. We don't need to know that, but we do need to know if there's a match, right? And anybody who's coming into the program is looking for that match, which is great. So now we have two people willing to try and find each other. And then when we find each other, that's when hopefully the story will come and we'll be able to promote that and inspire others. Yeah.
How big is your database?
It's small because we just started. We're only a 4-month-old company. So we're working to try and, like I said, grow through Rotary, hands on the ground, people that know each other, and we're going small first. So, but obviously the more people we get, the more matches there'll be. And because it's a targeted focus, I think the matches will come a lot quicker than if you just dump the DNA into a big system.
How does
different. I mean, we have a nonprofit, we're nonprofit and we have a profit component. So if anybody can pay, they pay, and if anybody can't, they go through the nonprofit section. So we're looking to try and bring in anybody who can participate, who wants to participate, participate regardless of economic situation, regardless of whether or not they, you know, they can afford it. So I think the nonprofit aspect of it is really positive for us. The other ones are just for profit.
Adoption agencies to visit them yet?
Yeah. Yes, we've tried to, and we're working on that. I mean, you know, it's a little bit different now with international adoptions. They're now certifying them through The Hague, where before they didn't do that, so a lot of the adoption agencies are falling off. But there's so many kids that have been out there already, because since the early 1990s, there's been, you know, thousands adopted out all these years. So all these kids are Marissa's age and a little bit older, and there's obviously younger ones too, but they're coming into their own, and they're looking, and they're curious, and they want to know. And if they can find each other, they can also get their medical history, you know, and put somebody else's mind at ease that they've survived, or, oh my God, you're doing this, and you look just like me, and, you know, there's things that are so helpful for people. There's other adoptees that couldn't care less whether or not they find anybody, you know, and that's okay too. They just probably won't participate. We're trying to get everybody in so that we can gather the data to be able to write to have the information to be able to provide it to these kids, because they need to know how many of them are in which country, how many of them are Jewish, how many of them are with this family, what issues they have. And we're trying to compile all that information.
Just a comment. See, I had thought that it was mandatory abortion, so I'm very happy to see that this is happening. I just thought, I could have sworn that I heard that they said second child not allowed to have, you have to abort.
Well, listen, what they may say you have to abort, but obviously they don't abort. What they do is they have them and they leave them in places where they can find them.
But what I'm saying is this is just a great case against it, because here you are.
Yeah, because in the first child too.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. Exactly. And these parents, they really want their kids to survive. I mean, they don't leave them up in the woods to die. I mean, Marissa was found on a bridge, a well-traversed bridge when she was a day old, because they wanted people to find her. Other people that she knows that were adopted at when she was, found at a police station, found at a church's door, found in a park where everybody is. So, you know, they really hope that their kids would wind up one day where they would wind up and be safe. Yeah.
You said it's $99 for someone to participate.
Yes.
Is that the actual cost?
Yes.
Of the test?
Oh, no. The actual cost is a little bit less. It's about $79, but then we have to pay $9 each time for we put them in the data bank. It's a one-time fee that we pay. And the data bank has agreed to reduce their price. They asked for a $10,000 deposit, but they waived that for us. And they're very excited about it because they're trying to get into this. They do a lot of criminal identification for DNA. They did some with the World Trade Center. They did some with other disasters. And we're their first project with regard to adoptions.
All right.
Okay, well, thanks very much, everybody.